والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. May الله سبحانه وتعالى bless our meeting. May الله عز وجل accept from us this action as عبادة. And may الله سبحانه وتعالى increase us all in the knowledge of the deen and understanding of the Quran, the word of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. As you know, brothers and sisters, inshallah we'll continue our discussion about some of the ayat of Surah Al-Baqarah. And as you see, we are, inshallah, today we'll start with ayah number 222 from Surah Al-Baqarah, hoping that we can finish up till ayah number 225. So I hope that the time will help us to finish this. In this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يسألونك عن المحيض قل هو أذى فاعتزلوا النساء في المحيض ولا تقربوهن حتى يطهرن فإذا تطهرن فأتوهن من حيث أمركم الله إن الله يحب التوابين ويحب المتطهرين. The meaning of this great ayah in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the translation of the meaning, saying, they ask you, O Prophet of Allah, about menstruation, which means woman menses, woman menses. Say, answer them, beware of its harm, or it is ada, it is harm itself, the blood that's come. So keep away and do not have intercourse with your wives during their monthly cycles until they are purified. When they purify themselves, then you may approach them in the manner specified by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Surely Allah azza wa jal loves those who always turn to him in repentance and those who purify themselves. Now let's go to this. Try to explaining the meaning of this ayat. It said by the word ask, they ask. And the question, why did the Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ask this question for the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam? Some of the reports in the Sunnah say that because the Muslims were in Medina, and as you know, all of these rules, all of these rules, although mostly revealed in Medina, not in Mecca. Mecca was concentrating to profound the Aqidah, believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Medina, it started the ayat which give legislation, rules, and law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in Medina, there was, as you know all, there was tribes of the Jew who migrated to Medina because they found the description of the place where the last prophet will come. So they arrived and settled in Medina long time before the coming of the prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, before Islam. So they settled there and they mixed with the people of Medina, which was called Yathrib before the migration of the messenger of Allah salatu wasalam. So the Sahaba, the people of the Medina, they hear many things from this Jew. One of the things they, you know, hear that women at the time of their menstruation are unclean. The woman is, you know, impure when she start her circle of menstruation. So they asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how about menstruation of women? And this question either they ask about what is the nature, or how can we deal with it, or is there any rules or regulation related to it? But in fact, the motive for this, what they hear from the Jew, and they know that the Jew, these Jew are the people of the book, and this what they got, maybe there's some glimpse of the revelation that was revealed to Musa alayhi salam. So they want to know and learn from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu عليه وسلم. And then the answer was, it is harm. It is harm. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala specified or started by mentioning the reason. Because it is a harm, then stay away from what? From having relation, bed relations with your wife. And this does mean, don't, that doesn't mean you should avoid contacting with them or sitting with them or eating with them. Or no, it's just this specific action. Don't, you should not have an intercourse, bed relation with your wife while at the time of their menses, because during this time, this blood that's come from them, it is harm. It is harm for them and it is harm for you because it's unclean. So here it is specific for this situation, this spot only. And this is why Allah Azza wa Jalla said, فَاعْتَزِلُوا النِّسَاءَ فِي الْمَحِيضِ. Therefore, should stay away, don't have relation, sexual relation with your wife during, at the time of the menstruation. So here, as you see, the Quran specified time and spot, place. The time is stopping having intercourse, relation with your wife at the time of her menses. This is the span of time till they purify themselves. The spot, only this is prohibited to have relation in this spot, to have an intercourse, which means the rest that you deal with them normally as any other time. While if you look at what the Bible say, it make women completely, not only the woman during her menses, whatever she touch, whatever place that she sit, whatever everything around her or she touch or she interact with is impure. And this is what I would like to share with you, because I know some of you familiar with the Bible, because many of you, mashallah, they, alhamdulillah, came as Muslim from Christianity or Judaism or Adi, or they have some knowledge about this. And this, my dear brothers and sisters, this is a good answer for those crusaders or those people of the book who always in their media, in their Islamophobia, in their propagation against Islam, they said Islam is the religion that oppressed women. Women have no value in Islam. This is what they said. Let's now check what the Bible said regarding this. At the book of Leviticus, which is one of the five books, as they said, of Moses in the Old Testament, at chapter number 15, most of this chapter talk about the state of woman during her menses. Now look what does it say. Woman, when a woman has flow of blood from her body, she'll be, she, look, she shall be in state of menstrual uncleanness for 7 days, okay? Anyone who touch her shall be unclean until the evening. So if you touch your wife in the morning and she was in the menses, that means you will be unclean till the evening. You, not her. And number 20 said, anything on which she lies or sits during her menstrual period shall be unclean. Anyone who touch her body shall wash his garment, not only his body, wash his garments, baths in water, and be unclean until evening. Even he wash and took bath, he's still unclean till evening. Whoever touch any articles, dish or spoon or book, any article on which she was sitting, shall wash his garments, bath in water, and be unclean until evening. More than this, if man lie with her, he contrasts her menstrual uncleanness and shall be unclean for 7 days. Every bed on which he then lie also become unclean. And then look at the one that I missed here. Whether an object is on the bed or on something she sat upon, when the person touched it, that person shall be unclean until the evening. When a woman has low blood for several days outside her menstrual, this is what we call it in Islam, istihada. Istihada, which is, it's not the regular period. The blood that's come after the woman ends her period. But look at the rules there at istihada in the Bible. It said her menstrual, or when her flow continue behind or beyond the ordinary period, as long as she suffer this unclean flow, she shall be unclean. Just during her menstrual period, which is different than Islam. In Islam, when the woman finish her period, it's just a matter of blood that's running. This running blood will not be considered the same rules as what? As her menses. She can make wudu, she can pray, she can ask. This is the difference here. The last point here, as you see it, any bed on which she lie during such flow becomes unclean, even during the istihada, as it would be during her menstrual period. And any article in which she sits becomes unclean just as during her menstrual period. Anyone who touches them becomes unclean. That person shall wash his garment, bathe in water, and be unclean until the evening. Oh, subhanallah. Now look to this, what we just mentioned in the Bible, and on the other side, look what the Quran and the Sunnah teach us. In the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look at this. Nu'aym ibn al-Fadl reporting عن عائشة رضي الله عنها أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يتكئ في حجري وأنا حائض ثم يقرأ القرآن. Narrated by عائشة رضي الله عنها, the mother of the believers, she said the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to lean on my lap and recite Quran while I was in menses. This hadith was reported by Al-Imam al-Bukhari. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he put his head on the lap of the Aisha رضي الله عنها. She is in her menses, menstruated that time. Not only he put his bed, but also recited the Quran. Not only touch her or touch the bed that she sat or the object that she touched, as it's mentioned in the Bible. Why? Because in Islam, as we said, it's mentioned in the ayah, it is limited to a span of time and to a certain spot. Don't deal with it. This spot, the source of this, the exit of this blood, you should not come near to it. You should not have intercourse, relation. Otherwise, you can enjoy your relation with your wife, foreplay, kissing, hugging, laying down. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was asked, how can we deal? How can I deal with my wife when she's in her menses? The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, you can do whatever you want except having intercourse with her. And for sure, not having, you know, relation from the back, because this is forbidden all the time. So look to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look to the logic, rationality in Islam. Look how much Islam respects women. Consider her as what? As a human being. She has right. And this is something that comes temporarily because of her nature. So this does not affect her as a pure regarding her. This is why the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّ الْمُؤْمِنْ لَا يَنْجَسُ أَبَدًا. The believer never been impure. The believer man or woman always pure and clean, even at the time that he has janaba. You know the janaba, see, which required total bathing. They call it major impurity. This is major impurity. It's not related to his, you know, character, his personality, or his body. No, no, no. This related to the what happened or what come after having relation for both man or woman, the husband or the wife. Always clean the Muslim always pure. So this impurity, it's just a state. It's not physical. It's a state of a situation that prevents the believer from doing certain matters, like reciting the Quran, like praying, like for women not fasting during her menses, like not having intercourse relation with the wife. It is limited to this. But the believer, man or woman, always pure, not as it's described in the Old Testament, which make the woman in her menses is unclean as impure, and whoever share or touch whatever she touch at that time will be considered impure. This is not the teaching of Islam. Look at this. Anas radiallahu anha mentioned this. And this, you see, explain why this ayah was revealed. He said, the Jew used not to eat with a woman during her menstruation period. This is what they knew. Because as we said, the Sahaba, they were mixing with the Jew at that time. So the Prophet ﷺ said, when they asked him, he said, do everything else apart from sexual intercourse with your wife. Don't stop dealing with them. You can kiss her, you can hug her, you can lay beside her, you can have foreplay, you can enjoy anything except intercourse. This was reported by an Imam Muslim. طيب. So from this, my dear brothers and sister, you see how much Islam put the reason why we what's the limit for this effect, which is natural for women, and how to deal with it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that, فَإِذَا تَطَهَّرْنَا, when they get pure, then you can have relation with them. That means intercourse. Here, it's very, very important point here. That means not only when the blood stop, be careful. فَإِذَا تَطَهَّرْنَا, that means after having ghusl. Therefore, here we have two conditions to resume the regular normal relation regarding to bed relation. What are they? One is the end of her menses. There's not enough, but she should make ghusl, take ghusl, bathing. So if the woman, for example, she already end her menses and she check herself and she found herself clean, there's no blood coming anymore, and there is a sign of you know, that she getting pure or clean, this is not enough for her husband to have intercourse with her. She should right away go and take ghusl, as you know, bathing with the niyyah of removing the major impurity, which is from menstruation, same as from janaba, which is from relation, and then her husband can have relation with her, she can pray, she can recite the Quran. So the limit for, or the effect of menstruation in Islam is related to certain periods, certain time. Now, what are the rules that related to this? Woman stop praying. And from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, she doesn't have to repeat or to redo all prayers that she missed during her menses. It's not required to do it again. She is excused. Show you the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Because some women, maybe they stay 10 days, 7 days, 12 days, more or less. Just imagine every day five prayers. So the mercy of Allah, Allah Azza wa Jalla forgave women from repeating or redoing the salah that they missed during their ministry. But for fasting, it's easy. It's easy. Same like the one who in the journey, the one who is sick, so she can make it up. Second, as we said, also related to no intercourse relation. But anything other than this, it's okay. It's okay. To the man and the wife and husband, they can enjoy each other except the intercourse during the menses of the time. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ التَّوَّابِينَ وَيُحِبُّ الْمُتَطَهِّرِينَ. Surely Allah loves those who repent and those who purify themselves. Now, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention the repentance here? Because the repentance is what? Purification from sin. When we commit sin and we repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ask Him His forgiveness, that means we purify ourselves from what? From the sin. So this purification from the sin, and as it's mentioned in the Sunnah of the Prophet who said, "Man taba at-taib min adh-dhanb kaman la dhanba lah." The one who repented from his sin that he committed, when he repented, as he didn't do any sin. This is mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So repenting, it will be related to spiritual repenting and physical repenting. So here Allah Azza wa Jalla said, التوابين, those who repent to Allah, clean themselves, purify themselves from what? From their sins, whatever wrong they did. And also, ويحب المتطهرين. And add to this, those who purify themselves. They keep clean, purify themselves. طيب. So let's go to now to some of the listen that we learned from this great ayah. This to show you that compared to Rasulullah give us the good example in the way of seeking knowledge, which is through asking many questions about things they need. This is the obligation of Muslim. Whenever, if there's anything that you don't know, you should ask, so this will increase your knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered question directed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this to show you that whatever the Prophet answered, it's not from his own, but it is a revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to show us also, and to prove that the one who put the law or regulation is not the Prophet, but Allah Azza wa Jal. This is why he answered them, say, this is the answer, O Prophet. Explaining the reason for the Islamic rules confirm the wisdom behind these rules, which people may know or not. Any rules, any regulation in Islam, there is wisdom behind it. Some of them we know. Some we may discover in the future. Some we may not know, because no matter how much we are smart and intelligent, we cannot comprehend the great wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which could be hidden for us. And this is as you hear. Allah Azza wa Jalla told us, first of all, say, because this is not clean, this blood that's come out is not clean, and it is harm at that time, and cause harm, then it is forbidden. So in our life, my dear brothers and sisters, in Islam, anything which is related to our worldly life, always, whenever Allah Azza wa Jalla say to you, don't do this, that means there is benefit for you. You may know or you may not know. He told you, don't drink alcohol. Okay, some people say, why not drink? This is night. No. Because in fact, as mentioned in previous ayat, we explain their harm is more worse than any benefit that you can get. Gambling. Some people say, what's the problem with? What's the problem with interest? I give somebody my money and he give me more money. There is wisdom behind this. Wisdom behind this. That people, when they get this, that means they will enslave other people with their monies. But it is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Starting the ruling by presenting the reason to make it easier to accept. You know, sometimes when you tell somebody, don't do this, he will ask you why. So to make him ready to accept your command, it is better to start by explaining the reason. Say, please, don't go this way. Don't say, don't go this way. Tell him, at the end of this way, if you drive, it will be deadlock. That means there is no way out. So go from this way. He will accept it right away. But if you tell him, don't go this way, he may not listen to you. He will go there, and then he will discover. And then he wasted his time, wasted his effort. So this look to the wisdom in Islam. Sometimes explaining and presenting the reason will make it more easier to accept the law. The abolition of sexual relation during women's menstruation. And we mean by sexual relation, the intercourse in the vagina, direct. But as we said, any foreplay, you know, related to the body, related to hug, kissing, talking, all these things, it is lawful. And this one, as you see it, Islam cares about cleanness and health safety of the husband of the wife. This is hard, so don't come near it because it is not clean. It may get some sickness or troubles as a result. Copulating is prohibited before the wife performs ghusl after her menses. As we said, it's not enough that the blood is end, but she should take ghusl to complete her purification. It is forbidden to have sexual intercourse in the back passage. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَأَتُوهُنَّ مِنْ حَيْثُ أَمَرَكُمُ اللَّهِ. Then approach them from the way that Allah ordained you. Which way? When he said, حَرْثٌ لَكُمْ. Your woman, it's like a land of harvest, of planting. And where does the man put his seed to his children? He put it in the vagina, in the front passage. So this is the way that it was ordained for what? For having relation. But the back passage, this is forbidden. All time, either during her menses or any other time. In fact, there is some hadith which he cursed the one who come or approach women from their back. But here I would like to explain one point. Because some people, they think that if you come from the backside, no. It's okay, you can approach your wife from the backside, left, I mean, from any side, front, back, as long as the place, the spot that used for intercourse is the front side or the front passage. But it doesn't matter if it's come from the backside. Confirm the attribute of love for Allah, as he said, that he loves those who repent and purify themselves. And this to encourage us always to be what? Purify ourselves. Purify, in Islam, purification, as we mentioned many times, it's not related to physical purification. It is related to purification of the heart, of the tongue, of the body, of the mind, of, the clothes, of the place. Always Islam encouraged to this. The virtue of repentance, because it is way to gain love of Allah, which means that the Muslim always, whenever he make any sin, even it is minor sin, he should run back and seek the forgiveness of Allah and repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right. This will explain for what we just mentioned. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, نساؤكم حرث لكم فأتوا حرثكم أن شئتم وقدموا لأنفسكم واتقوا الله واعلموا أنكم ملاقوه وبشر المؤمنين. Your wife are like a farmland for you. So approach them consensually as you please, anytime, any way that you like, from any side. And send for something good for yourself. Be mindful of Allah. Be careful that Allah is knowing your intention and knowing your action and can watch. He's watching you for that you will meet him. Remember this also. He's now seeing you, what you will do. One day you will meet him And then he will tell you about what you did and give good news to the believers. Good news to the believers. Now look at this ayat. How beautiful is it when it is subhanallah explain the way or the relation between the husband and his wife. And this is why, my dear brothers and sisters, it is forbidden to come from any side, I mean using intercourse from the back passage. Why? Because the purpose of relation between the husband and wife is to start a family, to be connected in one unit. And from this, it's like the relation between the, you know, the man or the farmer and his farm. So it is a production. Production for what? They having children. So this is, you see, look to this example, subhanallah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us about this. It's like farm. And this, my dear brothers, why in Islam, the children, they take the name of their father, not giving the name of the family of their mother. Why? Because the seed is the seed of the father. I mean the man. He's the one who plants the seed, which is the semen that's come. And the ground, the place, once what put there, it will grow by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be developed to a baby, to children they come. So the father, in fact, or the, this is why he is the one responsible about this offspring. That even if he divorced his wife, for example, during the time that she is breastfeeding his children, he have to spend in here. Just to show you, my dear brothers and sisters, the meaning of harth. That means you have relation, intercourse in the place where, you know, you can plant your seed, like the farmer when he plant the seed in his farm, not in the street, not in the building, and somewhere where else. It is very beautiful example here. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the warning that be careful, beware that you will meet him. So the Muslim, he take the command of Allah seriously. And he know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching them. Why? Because this is a matter of, as you know, a private relation. You know, the man, when he do this relation, he will not do it in public. But you should know that Allah is watching you, even if you are in secret, and even in your privacy. And remember that you will meet with him. Therefore, be aware, don't do anything that displease him or violate his command and do something which is he did not allow to you. And then he said, give glad tidings. So this is good news for the believers who live their life according to the teaching of Allah, according to the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that glad tidings of the good, great reward they will get, paradise and eternal life, happy life in the hereafter. Let's go to some lesson we learn it, or rules that we derive it from this ayah. Women are like a farmland of men. Man can enjoy his relation with his wife, but should treat her nicely. What does it mean nicely? You see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَقَدِّمُوا لِأَنفُسِكُمْ. And the Prophet ﷺ in some hadith, he said, when you come to have a relation with your wife, don't jump in here, okay? You should start with nice word, what we call foreplay. Try to prepare, you know, for this. And this to show you how much Islam encouraged us to be kind and very nice, soft with women, with our wives, especially, even when they are in the bed. So this is the teaching of Islam, how much respect, honor, and commanded us to take good care of our ladies. It is lawful to enjoy relation at any way as long as it is not in the forbidden side. Yeah, I don't mean forbidding side that you come from side. backside. That means the forbidden spot only the back passage. Don't, you should not have intercourse at that spot only. Otherwise, if man, for example, they have, he came from the back, and but he has intercourse in the front passage, that's okay, or from the other side. One should take good care of his wife. It is recommended to start having relation with some foreplay, as we mentioned. One should treat his family in the best kind way. And this is the teaching of Islam. Confirm the resurrection when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you will meet him. So this, remember that, that we all will return to him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Confirming meeting Allah and seeing him. For whom? For the believers. Every believer in the day of judgment, when he get into Jannah, paradise, the greatest reward that he will get in Jannah is what? Not paradise and food and women and, you know, all this joy. No. The greatest reward is to look at the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala get us to that time when we look at his face azza wa jal. The glad tidings for the believers in this life and the next one. The next ayah, وَلَا تَجْعَلُ اللَّهَ عُرْضَةً لِأَيْمَانِكُمْ أَنْ تَبَرُّوا وَتَتَّقُوا وَتُصْلِحُوا بَيْنَ النَّاسِ وَاللَّهُ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ. Do not use Allah's name in your oaths as an excuse for not doing good, not guarding against evil, or not making peace between people, and Allah is hearing, all hearing, and all knowing. Now, after, you see, this ayat started, you remember, last week, when we start this ayat, here, you can see it, ayat or of the Quran, which talk about family life. It started by saying, remember, last week, وَلَا تَنْكِحُ الْمُشْرِكَاتِ. Don't marry the polytheist woman. So the first point that was explained to us, that a Muslim man should not marry except Muslim woman or one of the people, the ladies of the people of the book, as we mentioned last week. And then we started talking about private relation. So he mentioned there a certain time which is not lawful to have intercourse with women in certain spot. So, and you will notice now, the following ayat all talk about relation with women, about divorce, about not having relation with them, about, the question is here, why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he spoke about swearing? This you will understand it when we come to the next ayat, which talk about ila. Because there's some people or some husband, he may make swear that he will not have relation with his wife. But here the ayah started with general point about swearing, not only related to the family life, in general. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا تَجْعَلُ اللَّهَ عُرْضَةً لِأَيْمَانِكُمْ. Which means, don't use swearing in a way that stop you from doing good. Like say, for example, I swear that I will never give charity to this person. Why? Because giving charity is good. So how come you swear? Maybe because he was angry with him. And this happened during the time of Sahaba, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, radiallahu anhu. He swear that he will not give mastah. Mastah, he is a relative of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, radiallahu anhu, among the immigrants, the Sahaba, and he was a relative, and he was poor. So Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, radiallahu anhu, used to support him financially. But when you remember the problem of ifk, when people, they make rumors about Aisha, radiallahu anha, that she have an illegal relation with one of the Sahaba, and this is mentioned in Surah An-Nur, and this allegation, Allah Azza wa Jal defended her from this and purified her from what they said. So Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, radiallahu anhu, after, you know, Allah Azza wa Jal revealed the purification of Aisha, radiallahu anha, and she those who accused her, they are committing sin and they were punished for what they said. And one of among them is Masdah. So Abu Bakr al-Siddiq swear that he will never help him financially. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed other ayah, the same surah An-Nur, وَلَا يَأْتَلِ أُولُو الْفَضْلِ مِنْكُمْ وَالسَّعَةِ أَنْ يُؤْتُوا. So don't swear not to helping those immigrants, those needed. Even they did wrong. Forgive them. So this is the ayah he said, don't use swearing as an excuse not to do good. For example, your relative, your cousin is sick and you have dispute with him and he's in the hospital and your family tell him, go and visit so-and-so. He is very sick. He may die. Say, no, no, no. I already swear that I will never come to visit him. Here, it is wrong. This is the answer for those people who make such this swearing. So Allah Azza wa Jalla said, don't make this swearing always. And this also, my dear brothers and sisters, command us not to take swearing in Allah easily. So always say, wallahi, 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 especially when you are making swear. So the ayah said here, don't make this swearing or oath that you did with the name of Allah as an excuse from not making something which is good. And this from this ayah, as you see, we learn this lesson. And the next ayah, which is completed for this, لا يؤاخذكم الله باللغو في أيمانكم ولكن يؤاخذكم بما كسبت قلوبكم والله غفور حليم. Allah will not hold you accountable for an intentional oath, but for what you intend in your hearts. And Allah is full of forgiveness, most forbearing. What is the unintentional? This is, as you know, we repeat always. It's become sometimes as a habit for a person. He said to so, wallahi, today I do this. Wallahi, yesterday I met so and so. Wallahi, wallahi. He didn't mean it. It's just a word because his tongue used to repeat it. So Allah Azza wa Jalla is telling us, Allah will not hold you accountable for this because he didn't mean this. But you will be responsible. You will be accountable when you say the word swearing and you intend in your heart that you mean it. They said, I mean this. When he said, oh, wallahi, I will not do this. And you intend in your heart that you make this oath to prevent yourself from do it again. This is what will be considered as yameen that need what we call it compensation or kafar. Learn from this ayat. Prohibition of making an oath prevent one from doing something good. This was explained by the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Abu Hurairah radiallahu an said, the Messenger of Allah ﷺ said, when you swear an oath and consider something else to be better than it, make expiation for your oath and do the thing that is better. As we said, for example, you swear not to visit your relative who is sick, and you meant this, that's mean from your heart. What should you do here? Now, you should not take this oath that you did as an excuse of not doing this good. You should do this good, but then also you have to make compensation, kafara, for this swearing. And you know, the kafara for al-yameen is either freeing a slave or feeding 10 needies or clothing 10 needy people. If you didn't find these, then you can fast 3 days. And this is very important because some people, you know, they confuse. Now, whenever they make an swearing, okay, and they want to compensate for their swearing, what they do? Yeah, right away they go and fast 3 days. No. If you are able to feed 10 needy people, that's mean you give 10 meals to 10 poor people, then you should not go for fasting. to fasting right directly. You should feed or you should give clothes. If you are not able financially, you cannot do it, then you move to the next option, which is the other option, which is fasting. Encouraging doing good and solving dispute and making reconciliation among people. The high virtue of making reconciliation between people. If you know that there is dispute between your friends, your family, your neighbors, your classmates, workmates, it is highly, highly rewarded from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is one of the great area of getting reward from Allah. Try to get them close together and solve this dispute between them. One should be cautioned in violating the commands of Allah, as he said, Allah hear. So that means whatever you say is already heard. Know, which means he know if this word that you say, is it an oath based on your intention or just a matter of repeating word that you get used to it. The mercy of Allah Azza wa Jalla, who forgives an intentional oath. Otherwise, you know, we say this word, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. The importance of the action and intention in the heart. Always we say, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. As you remember the hadith. And this hadith is very important in all of our life, which means Allah Azza wa Jalla hold you accountable for what? For what you intend to do. Therefore, it is required in any ibadah, before you do it, you should start it in your heart. And niyat for prayer, for ghusl, for everything. I'll give you an example, maybe some people are aware of. For example, some people, they ask, if I, after I have relation with my, I took ghusl. Even when you took ghusl, put in your mind the purpose, the intention of having this water or this bathing is what? To get rid of the state of janaba. Not just go and take bath. If the intention is not there, this will not be enough. Why? Because you should intend when you take ghusl to purify yourself from the janaba. Allah holds one accountable for what the heart intended only when the person acts accordingly. And this is out of the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal. You see, it is mercy of Allah that if you intend something, for example, committing sin, and you didn't do it, Allah Azza wa Jal forgive you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive you. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned at the end of Surah Al-Baqarah, رَبَّنَا لَا تُؤَاخِذْنَا إِن نَسِينَا وَخَطَأْنَا رَبَّنَا وَلَا تُحَمِّلْنَا مَا لَا طَاقَةَ لَنَا بِهِ. The ayah said, وَلَا تُحَمِّلْنَا مَا لَا طَاقَةَ لَنَا بِهِ. Which means, oh Allah, don't hold us accountable for something beyond our ability. Some of the things that what's come to our mind, what's come to our heart. For example, a person, maybe he saw something, saw a woman, and he dreamed about having a relation with her, for example, which is forbidden. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not hold you accountable for this thought that come to your mind or in your heart unless you do it. You want to do anything which is wrong, but then you thought about it and said, oh, astaghfirullah, I should not do this, is haram. If you give up, not do it, Allah will give you reward. One reward, one hasana. Why? Because you did give up something which is wrong and you didn't do it because you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why there is the difference between the good deeds and the bad deeds. The good deeds, if you do it, you will get 10 times reward. If you didn't do it, you will get also one hasana. One good deed will be counted for you. Why? Because you intended, because you thought about it. But for the bad deed, if you thought about it, you will not be accountable for it. If you did it, it will be accountable for one bad deed. If you give up, you didn't do it, you say, astaghfirullah, I will give you, count for you one good deed. Why? because you gave up, you didn't do it. So he looked at the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Confirming the attribute of Allah Azza wa Jal, because he's the one who forgive and forbear. One should never despair from the mercy of Allah. At the same time, should never feel secure against Allah planning and Allah punishment. You see, my dear brothers in Islam, you see, people are between two sides. Some, they live their life fearing from Allah and they forget about His mercy. And the other side, people, they have always hope and they have to say, Allah is merciful. So they don't care. They do many things bad and they say, Allah is merciful. But the Muslim should be very balanced. Should be balanced. That means you should not, you know, first bear from what, you know, the mercy of Allah. At the same time, should be careful. Don't follow your desire and say, Allah is merciful. So there should be balance between what? Hope and fear. Hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and fear from violating His command because His punishment is very severe. And by this, alhamdulillah, we come to the end of our presentation today. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala benefit us from whatever we say, from whatever we learn, and we leave, alhamdulillah, today we have a few minutes more for our question or any comments from our brothers and sisters. So if there's anybody who have any question, please, you can ask.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome, Sister Amina. Go ahead.
Thank you. Ustaz, some women come to me. I am an Islamic counselor, actually. They want to know one thing: when the way you have mentioned doesn't happen, like the when the men don't approach the women in a kind manner, like you said, jump on them or something like this, words you have used, is what is their position, that they have to just stay patient because they say it is harming them? Can you give any guideline for such women? Of course, we know it's not the right thing to do, but what can they want to know how they have to handle this because they're saying it is harming them. Okay, if you can give me any answer on this. Thank you.
Well, your sister, because I get lost, you know, mashallah, you give many explanation about the point. So what is the exact point that you want to know about?
Exact point is the ayah is saying very clearly, approach the women in a kind manner, like you have explained. Okay, so if the men are not kind and being very hasty, what should a woman do because it is harming her?
Okay, so this is what we said. Dealing with the wife is nicely. And not only with the wife, Islam is consider us, I mean commanded us, to deal whatever we do it in ihsan. What does it mean, ihsan? In the best possible way. Even the private relation, as we said, between the husband and the wife. I mean, not because the husband has the right. This is his right to have relation with his wife. He said, this is my right. And he just jump and do it, you know, in a way for maybe the lady is not ready for it. Maybe she is in grief, for example. Maybe she lost someone. Maybe she is at that time, she is very tired because of the work of the home. Maybe she, there's any many, many different reasons, even psychological, she's not ready for this. This is why it is approaching should be very nicely, and this will be referred to the wisdom of the man to understand and choose the right time, the right place, the right maybe moment, and maybe use the best approach, the best approach that may make this matter, this relation acceptable or more welcome from his wife. Sister Amina, I just would like to, because it, well, I remember 2 weeks you asked about the meaning of the word of fitna. And then
yes,
I mentioned, you remember this maybe,
you see,
about fitna. The word of fitna, we said at that time, because it's related to what we were discussing, related to any desire or any things or any matter that force the person to do something which is not right. But in general, when we talk about the word fitna, as I explained at that time, it was took from fatan al-dahab, that's mean when they put the gold, they put it in the fire, so they clean it from anything, you know, which is not connected with it. So it will be pure gold. From this, the word fitnat was taken with many general meaning, which include what? Include any crimes, any test, any examination or exam or any trial that touch the person, either something which is he like or dislike. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that our wife, our children are fitna. What does it mean? That means maybe when your wife or your child, maybe he will keep you busy till you forget your or you may neglect some of the duties that you should do for Allah. For example, salah. Maybe your family, your kids, they, you know, wasting your time till you miss the salah. So this is fitna. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also fitna. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put you in trial to test how much you are strong in your faith. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Ankabut, Alif Lam Mim, حسب الناس أن يتركوا أن يقولوا آمنا وهم لا يفتنون. Do people think that they will say just we believe without يفتنون? That means will both be in trial. So here the word fitna came as trial that a person may go through. I hope this maybe just add to the explanation that I did before, because I thought it's very important to understand the word fitna in more broad meaning.
Yes, Sheikh, I also went back and I looked at 5-6 meanings of the word Mustafa Qattab, Sahih International, Mohsin Fund. They are also using like oppression and injustice. Like also it's like fitna.
Why it is to consider as fitna? Because, you know, oppressing somebody, and this is what we say, the trials, it could be it's come in something that a desire, another thing, side, it's come as harm. And this
yes.
oppressing, for example, this persecuting, for example, like what the disbelievers sometimes they do with the believers, this persecution, consider as fitna. Same as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Buruj. Surah Al-Buruj. الَّذِينَ فَتَنُوا الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَتُوبُوا. Those who persecuted or oppressed those believers, فَتَنُوا, the believers, and they did not repent it. So, and then before this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, what's the type of fitna they did? They dig hole in the ground, and they fill it with fire, and they used to throw the believers. Anyone who say, I believe, they will throw them in that. So this was type of fitna, as you said. Now,
JazakAllah.
Yes,
very
Sister
nice
Ilham.
Explanation.
Barakallah feek.
Thank you very much.
Go ahead, Sister Ilham.
I just have a question. What can you say, or what's your opinion, or the rulings like? When someone uses the name of Allah, like it's not in taking oaths, but yani for threatening someone, if he's receiving or he's receiving like maltreatment or he's receiving like that, like you use the name of Allah and you say to him or to her like Hasbi Allah alaik. What's the ruling for this, Sheikh? Like you threat someone just to stop what he's doing bad to you, like you say Hasbi Allah alaik. What's the ruling for this, Sheikh?
Well, this is, you see, always a Muslim, we said, always, you know, be nice and kind, even be patient with anybody who do harm to him. But if a person say, Hasbi Allah wa ni'mal wakil, no problem with this. That's mean you turn to Allah Azza wa Jal to support you and to help you. But sometimes if somebody did something wrong, or, you know, treat you badly, and you say to him, Hasbi Allah alayk, this also, it's like venge against him. He will feel bad, and maybe he will act in correct manner. So it's better always the Muslim should be very wise, asking for him, for example, guidance. May Allah guide you. Because if we get used to this word, sometimes maybe we use it in the wrong time with the wrong person. Maybe your child or your husband or your brother do something and you get very angry and say, Hasbi Allah, and this is not right. This is not good. And then you will regret what you said.
Because I saw some like a video of this, like in online, like they're saying they are advising, especially us workers here, because some unfortunately not all of us get the right treatment from our employer. So they're saying say this to them if they tell them that this word to them, and while if you receive this bad treatment from them, and then you say this, and they will be scared. Like maybe it's according to the intention also, Sheikh, if you say, well, now
Yes, but
what?
the boy, but the point here, when you say something, any action that we do, it will have response from the others, right? Those we talk to him, either this is a word or physical action. People will, I mean, there's reflection for whatever we do. Therefore, as we said, we always, when we deal with people, we try to be kind and nice. And then you make dua. This is the best thing for us. Make dua. So, for example, this person who harmed you, if he's a believer, he's a Muslim, instead of praying to Allah, to, oh Allah, give me revenge from him, it is not recommended this way. It's recommended to say, oh Allah, guide him. Oh Allah, keep me away from his harm. You don't know. Maybe this person one day, he will change his style, his approach. He will consider, or maybe he review himself and he found that he did harm for you. And then he won't intend to correct in the way that he did before. So it is not recommended, to say it to anybody in front of him. You ask Allah Azza wa Jal help, you turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's better than making or saying these words in front of him. This is what I think, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the best. طيب, I think our time is over. وإياك. Our time is over. بارك الله فيكم. So see you inshallah next week in our class. بارك الله فيكم. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us all in the knowledge of the deen and bless us all. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.